attention to the announcements in the bulletin. There are several people that we're praying for, and also some information about some small groups and other things that we have going on in our church. If we have any visitors with us, please fill out the little bookmark that's in the queue in front of you. Save the top portion as a reminder of your visit here today, and just drop the information with your address in the offering for you today. Also, if everyone can please register your attendance on the pew pad and fill out any prayer request forms, they will be collected shortly. We do have a couple of announcements today, so why don't we start first with Danny?
Well, good morning. I have two things to announce this morning. First, we have a children's coordinator that's beginning her services, and that'll be Alice Reynolds. And secondly, we have our choir director is going to be Janice Ellenson. I started with this announcement 6 weeks ago, but I know how everybody likes to talk and visit.
Well, we had kids night out last night, and we ended up having 9 kids, which was a good start for us. We were able to interact with them, and we had a little more time than we thought we were going to have, so we were like coming up with ideas. I said, okay, we're going to color. They went right to, you know, color, no problems, no, you know, no complaining. I cannot thank everybody enough for helping and for everybody who donated. We had plenty of candy, and they all took their candy home, and there's Minions back there. That's what we made as one of the crafts, and please help yourself and take them with you. Thank you.
And next, Janet Jones.
Good morning. I'd like to draw your attention to the Christmas tree back in the fellowship hall and the green insert in your bulletin. This is our campaign for the Caring Place, which is a shelter for abused men, women, and children. The United Methodist Women recently went to Caring Designs, which is an outreach of the Caring Place. And it's a resale shop for furniture, but they also supply furniture for a whole apartment free for clients when they graduate from the Caring Place shelter to an apartment. Because as you know, when these women arrive at the shelter, they and the children, they literally have the clothes on their back. And so they have no furniture, the majority of them. And we had a wonderful program about the Caring Place and its connection with Caring Designs. And it was very educational, and the Caring Place has been able to help so many women and children and men. And anyway, the tags, please take the tags off, and that you're interested in purchasing the gift, bring it back unwrapped, and buy a little or a lot. And I suggest shopping, or at least pricing things at the dollar store, because things are quite reasonable there. One thing, they do not want little sample bottles of shampoo or conditioner. They want, you know, regular size bottles, but I think they sell those for a dollar at the dollar store. So, and Dollar Tree. And so there's lots of things that should fit in your budget. If you would like me to do your shopping for you, just see me after church. I'll be happy to do that. And we have till the end of July for this program. So we're helping a lot of people. And they shared with us that one woman came with 8 children to the shelter at one time. And it was difficult for them to accommodate that. But they were able to. And when men come, I believe they provide alternate housing for them. I know at one time they had a large motel bill because they were putting men in the motel, or they direct them to the men's homeless shelters, and those people are housed in different churches overnight in the Mount Pleasant area. So there's a lot to think about here, and I just wanted to share a little bit about that with everyone. And I want to thank the United Methodist Women for helping me make the tanks during work day. So that lightened my load a little bit. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, see me. Thanks.
Do we have any other announcements? Okay, well, why don't we take a few minutes and greet our friends and neighbors.
I'm sorry, I have to laugh because I'm looking out here, this side's all screwed up, and this side's all screwed down. Look out, never mind. Have a stand, please, stand up. How much would you give, or maybe I should say, how much would you give up in order to help someone? You know, it was struck by the thought, Pastor Patty said something about the nine kids. How much would you give up in order to help someone? Now, I was struck by the thought, Patty said something about the nine kids, which at first glance you're thinking, but Christ said we're two or more gathered. Nine's good, because it's nine people we didn't reach otherwise, and so that's just awesome. So how much would you give, or how much would you give up? God gave his son so that our sins would be forgiven. You can't give a whole lot more than that. Sing this, please.
Every lip confess. sings, my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
We have the contact information in the office if you would like to make that contact. I'm going to be following up with her today to see if she has gotten moved yet. But the family needs a lot of prayer. Alan needs a lot of prayer, and that's her husband. And I know that they're discerning what God has in store for them for their next steps. In addition to that, Bonnie and Dan McConnell are uplifting Alan Zellers and his family. Prayer for life decisions for Alan. He is in a critical condition. He hit his head while driving his motorcycle. So that's a horrific accident. Let's keep that family in prayer and see God's grace and mercy for them. Stephanie uplifts Neil Wilbur, healing after heart surgery, and that went very well. So praise God. Thank you for that update. We definitely will continue to pray for his convalescence and healing. Spencer Hill has been diagnosed with cancer. Stephanie was sharing with us. So please, let's uplift him, his family, and all those who love and care for him, those that know him, please. And then I don't know if this is a prayer request or just a statement, but it says here, the need is Jesus was a salesman. So I have a sermon for that in mind. Maybe it's time to pull that out. So when you see it on the marquee, me, Fred, and Zig Ziglar, you'll know that's what we're going to be talking about on that day. So let us take a moment and let's begin an attitude of prayer. Oh, wait, we have a prayer request in the back.
Yeah, I do. I didn't fill out a card, but our daughter-in-law is going to be induced at 7 o'clock Saturday morning for the 20th. If she doesn't Tuesday morning at 7 if something doesn't happen between now and then. So just prayers for her and Michael.
Absolutely. Tuesday morning, we're going to do that. But you never know what God's plans are.
Amen.
May come soon. Yes.
All the tests turn back negative.
Amen.
So it needs more tests. Kind of.
God blesses us in amazing ways.
And I have a birthday.
A birthday Wednesday.
So I'm, one more year.
Amen to that. Amen to that. We have a birthday girl here in the front pew. It's a birthday tomorrow, as a matter of fact.
Right.
You're welcome very much.
29.
Again. Amen to that. Are there any other guests?
I'm listening to Janet talking about the Karen place.
Yes.
Prayers for women, children who have been betrayed by their husbands that they love.
Did everyone hear that? We're uplifting prayers for those who are going to the Karen place and all the circumstances that causes them to be there. No matter what the circumstances are, for all that prayer. Prayer request, go ahead.
I have a praise. David's stepmom, Dottie Ruska, is home from the hospital and is doing better. She's on oxygen, and it's going to be a slow road, I think, to recovery, but she is home. And then also, wanted to ask for prayer for the Pickell family. I believe his name was Don Pickell, passed away after falling through his attic onto a concrete floor, and his wife was a good friend of David's from high school, and they were both, they're retired music teachers here in the area. Just that family is really struggling right now, so the Pickell family, please.
Absolutely, and I'll need to get the proper spelling of that from my okay. Any other prayer requests? Yes?
I have a prayer request for Mary. She gets through the circumstances, and she knows that God's love, that God loves her, and whatever's going to happen to her best.
Yeah.
I just want to thank the Walkers, and they're such a blessing. As you all know, we have car trouble occasionally, and they came to Amherst Rescue with a car for her to borrow while she needs.
Amen. Let us go to God in prayer, shall we? Heavenly and gracious Lord, we come to you this morning. So many things are on our hearts. Help us to understand who we are, as that we are made in your image. And that alone makes each and every one of us unique. That makes each and every one of us with great potential inside. That makes each and every one of us a child of God with unlimited possibilities. Help us to open our hearts, our minds, our very being to encompass all those great and wonderful possibilities. Let us reach out with all that we have and all that we are to God and our neighbors, all those around us, some that we know, some that we do not know, and some that we are estranged from or have no earthly clue who they are. Help us as your people to recognize the sacred worth of all, and that we hold each and every one with love and deep regard. Lord, we have many things that are in our hearts this morning, and many people that we reach out to for healing and for convalescence, for care and for the presence. Enable us to discern where we are called to be and what we should be doing to love our neighbor as ourselves. Let us take a moment and go to God in prayer individually. Gracious and loving Lord, we come to you this morning uplifting all that's on our hearts and bearing our souls to you. Let us now say the prayer that your Son not only taught his disciples, but taught us as well, by saying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Sometimes when he did parables, he kind of did comparisons, okay? Well, I think we're going to talk about the Good Samaritans today, or the Good Samaritan, and I want us to be Good Samaritans, okay? But I have a short story from one of my favorite authors named Dr. Seuss that I thought we might use as a little comparison. Got some books all boxed up because we've been doing some painting, so I can't find one of my favorite stories called Horton Hears a Who. You guys know that story?
Yeah.
It's about the elephant in Mice in the Movie. Okay. Well, I'll give you the short version. It goes like this. Hang on. Horton was an elephant, you know, right? So he's kind of big. And one day he was splashing around this cool jungle pool. And he heard this little tiny voice crying for help. He looked all around, and he didn't see anyone. And all he saw was this tiny speck of dust. Now, if you've been at my house, you've seen a lot of specks of dust. But he saw this tiny speck of dust floating through the air. Horton realized that on that little speck of dust, there were people calling out for help. As it turned out, there was a whole town of people on that little speck of dust. They were calling out for help because they were afraid that the speck of dust would fall into the pool of water and they would drown. Even though they were so small, he couldn't see them, Horton made up his mind
that he was going to help them. After all, he said, a person's a person, no matter how small. Now, all of the other jungle animals thought Horton was crazy. They're not like us. Why would you do that? First a kangaroo, then some monkeys and an eagle. They all made fun of Horton. They shunned him, you know. He was helping somebody that they shouldn't have been helping. Well, why would you say, let me kill those people on a speck of dust?
Because they're people.
Well, you know the story, don't you? Hang
yes.
on a minute. Hang on. I'll let you answer your questions in a minute. Even though none of the other animals would help him, Horton refused to give up. He remained faithful to the task of saving those tiny people who needed his help. And because of his faithfulness, the tiny people were saved. And finally, the other animals realized that just as Horton said, a person's a person no matter how small. Okay. Now I want to show you a little short clip. It's the Lego version of the Good Samaritan. Whoa, Jim.
One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question. Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus replied, what does the law of Moses say? How do you read it? The man answered, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus told him. Do this and you will live. The man wanted to justify his actions, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling on a trip from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along. But when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant walked over and looked at him lying there, but he also passed over on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I'll pay you the next time I'm here. Now which of these 3 would you say was the neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, the one who showed him mercy. Then Jesus answered, yes, now go and do the same.
That's a really brilliant question. And you know what? It doesn't have to be a man on the road. It could be somebody in this church. It could be somebody in the caring place that we talked about this morning when we prayed. It could be somebody at recess. It could be somebody on a bike ride that fell, you know, helping them. I love your question, bud. But I wanted to come back and kind of compare Horton to this story, if you don't mind. Just who is my neighbor? This teacher of the law asked Jesus. What he was really saying was, do you really expect me to help everybody? What about people like me? Help them, right? But surely you don't expect me to be kind to everyone. Not everybody's like us, you know. Well, in the story of Horton, the animals in the jungle were like that teacher of the law. And the priest and the Levite that kind of walked by, you know, the injured person. They made fun of Horton for helping the people on that speck of dust. They thought he was crazy for helping them. But Horton, he was kind of like the Good Samaritan who helped the man, right? He went out of his way to help those people on that speck of dust. Now, it doesn't matter. Your neighbor is someone who might be just like you. They might be different. They might be from Hebrew. They might be from Africa. Or German. Or a poor. They might be speak speak a different language. It might be a different color. It might be somebody that you like. It might be somebody that you don't like very much. But always remember, every person is your neighbor. Be like Courtney. A person's a person, no matter how small. And if we can show love to them in some way, then we're showing them the love of Jesus, and we're being good Samaritans. Will you pray with me? Dear Jesus, it is not always easy to be a good neighbor. And sometimes we don't even know when we're supposed to be a good neighbor, but you give us opportunity. Every day, in big ways and small. There are some people that are very easy to like and love, and there are people that are not hard to like and love. But please help us to be like you and love them like you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
One more question. What did Kung Fu Panda have to do with any of this?
Oh, it was just a song where he got hurt and beat up. That's all.
I know. I just wanted to bring that up.
Oh, well, you're very observant. All right. Thank you, guys.
Bye.
From the book of Matthew, for I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.
How do you interpret it? He responded,
You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said to him, you have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. But as the legal expert wanted to prove that he was right, so he said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He encountered thieves who stripped him naked, beat him up, and left him near death. Now it just so happened that a priest was also going down the same road. When he saw the injured man, he crossed over to the other side of the road and went on his way. Likewise, a Levite came by that spot, saw the injured man, and crossed over to the other side of the road and went on his way. A Samaritan, who was on a journey, came to where the man was. But when he saw him, he was moved with compassion. The Samaritan went to him and bandaged his wounds, tending them with oil and wine. He then placed the wounded man on his own donkey, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took 2 full days' worth of wages and gave them to the innkeeper. He said, take care of him, and when I return, I will pay you back for any additional costs. What do you think? Which one of these three was a neighbor to the man who encountered thieves? Then the legal expert said, the one who demonstrated mercy towards him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise.
Word for God's people.
Praise be to God.
Would you be in an attitude of prayer with me, please? Holy and loving Lord, you have called us to be a people known by our love for each other and for our love of you. You have emphasized how important this is to you and for our own good. How do we do this in this place and at this time? What are we being called to do this day? Can we just sit back and make excuses for not getting involved with the world? How should we open ourselves up to your Holy Spirit? Why are there so many blind today? And help us to see a world through your eyes. Help us to reach out rather than make excuses why we cannot do something. Help us to do it by living it. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. How are your weeks this week?
Good.
Hopefully nobody here has had an ugly week. And if there is ugliness, let someone know and let us pray for you. Prayer is the only thing that can help ugly. Only thing. We've heard now the story of the Good Samaritan a few times today. We've heard it in Sunday school. We've heard it a number of times. We've seen it demonstrated in a number of places. And it's probably one of the most read, most retold parables that we have in all of our faith traditions. How many are unfamiliar with the parable of the Good Samaritan? Anybody? Was this the first time that you've ever heard it? Well, I know that you heard it this morning in Sunday school. So everyone's heard it, everybody is familiar with the parable of the Good Samaritan, right? Okay, good. So what do we do with it? Rather than spend time talking about the parable, what do we do with it? How do we wrestle with it? What does it mean to us? How can we as a people today embody what Christ has clearly said that is our responsibility? Clearly has told us what we need to do. Clearly has explained all the parameters that it holds. I mean, it's tough, isn't it? At least I found it difficult. Because not everybody's on the same page. Let me give you some examples. And see if you can empathize or at least hear something of yourself in them. My wife and I are driving down the road. Kids are real small. Got one in the car seat, got the other one sitting next to it. There's a person who's needing help on the side of the road. I, without thinking, pull over, have him hop in the car, and we take off. My wife is having a nervous meltdown because she doesn't know who this person is, whether they're going to pull out a knife and slit our throats or rob us or hurt us or do whatever. A lot of fear there. I wasn't even thinking like that. Completely off the page with her. Now, we had a conversation after I dropped him off.
A big one.
Now, for those who are shocked by that, for those who are shocked by that, that isn't just being naive on my part. That's not what that's about. It's about understanding human beings as being categorically different than every other part of creation. And that's where this comes from. You see, I've had it said to me multiple times is that why should we care for someone who's only going to take advantage of us? And my response is, so what? So what? Our problem in our society, as I see it, now this is Ed Fisher talking, and so I'm putting a little asterisk, so you can tune me out if you like, it's okay. The asterisk is this, is that our society has been raised to understand itself as being good consumers. Being a consumer is in opposition to the gospel. It clearly tells us this over and over and over again and demonstrates it in the parable. Because we are not to expect to get something for giving something. We give everything to God without regard. It's called disinterested religion. If you'd like to learn more about that, plug in. We're meeting on Thursday afternoons at Misty Glen, and we're reading about Job and learning about disinterested religion. Disinterested religion is the belief in the love of Lord God without expecting anything in return. Nothing. If you happen to go to a corner and you see someone standing there in that corner holding that sign saying, "Food, please," how many of you are willing to stop and invest in that person? You don't have to raise your hands. Think about it. Are they not a child of God just like you are? And if they supposedly take advantage of you, so what? You see, the parable clearly states that our obligation is to care for someone until they can care for themselves. Period. End of discussion. No need to do it any further. That's what it says. You can't undo what it says in the book. And you can try to interpret it any way you want, but the bottom line is that it clearly states he cared for him, paid his bill, and said he would pay whatever it took when he got back. Now, what does that mean for us in today's world? It means that we have to be willing to risk something that we are told since we're small children not to risk. What's that? What is the story telling us to risk that we are told as little children do not risk? Your life. Perhaps. What else? What else are we being told to risk that we're told as children never to risk?
Our faith.
Our faith? Okay. What?
Stranger danger.
Bingo! We need to risk going to places that we are told not to do. We are risking, well, how many adages do we have? We throw, let's see, how does it go? Pearls before swine, a fool and his mother soon parted. We are trained since little children to get something for our money. Exchange X for Y. If you don't get more than what you give out, then there's something wrong. The Good Samaritan, the story, the gospel, is not about what we get out of it. We always will come up short if we do. How in the world can you put a value on the needs of others? When do you know that you've gotten your deal's worth? How do you measure it? That's not our concern. We are not ones to judge. We are not ones to measure. We are ones to do and to act and to be. Now, we have lots of examples in our world today, and it scares me to death to see the world in the state that it's in. Fear is rampant. Fear undermines love like no one's business. Fear prevents us from getting up in the morning. Fear prevents us from reaching out to others. Fear prevents us from being loving people. Fear prevents us from giving everything to God. We need to let go of that fear and believe and trust
We need to believe and trust in the Lord and Savior. Now, I know you can't just reach out and get a hold of Jesus like you would like to. It would be so much more convenient for us if we had Jesus right here and said, okay, Lord, whatever you want to do, we got you right here. I know you're right here, and you're not going to leave us. I know you're going to have our back, so yeah, we'll go out there. We'll do it. But we lack faith. When you look at the events of the world around us, where are the people of faith? Securely behind the doors of the church? Securely in their homes, in their beds? Where are the people of faith? Why are not we as a people outraged? Why are we not as a people reaching out? And you would say, well, that's over there. That's not here. How many of us have seen the tragedy of human life in our own backyard and have refused to accept it as being real? Well, we'll just write a check and be done with it. We'll throw something at it. It'll be okay. Well, that's their responsibility over there. Why don't we just have a one-time-a-year fundraiser, put it all in a bag, and send it off? You see, the message of the gospel also tells us that we have to get dirty. We have to roll up our sleeves. We have to be willing to risk to smell bad. Life does stink. Life reeks. And you end up risking a lot. You do. You risk being with people that other people don't want you to be with. You risk, maybe losing some sleep, or maybe not having all of the immediate cash at your disposal that you think that you should have. You might risk missing out on an event that's important to you and your family in order to care for someone else. It happens. It happens. You might even be, you might be ostracized by some of your friends because of what you did. That happens. Happened to me. Happened to us. We're still alive. We're still kicking. We're still here. And I'm sure it's happened to some of you in this room. If you're not willing to risk everything from God, then what are you willing to risk? You see, it's easy to sit back and let others do. And it's even easier to sit back and let others do and throw rocks. The sad truth is, as human beings, we are also confined by culture, is that we can't imagine a world any different than the world that we expect to find when we wake up every morning. If anything, the parable teaches us that we need to let go of our preconceived notions of human beings. We need to let go of our preconceived notions, honestly, of what we see versus what we know. If we are not willing to risk for the sake of the gospel, then why are we here? Now, there are a lot of wonderful things that are going on around us. And there are a lot of wonderful people involved in a lot of wonderful things. That doesn't take anything away from that whatsoever. If anything, it opens the door for us to participate. If anything, it opens the door for us to jump into the water with someone else. If anything, it allows us to get dirty with friends. It's a lot more fun to get all messy with people you know and work at getting cleaned up together than being all by yourself. It's a lot more fun. The difficulty is that when the day arrives when you need people, where are you? Let's be specific for a minute or two. At the crux of what we read in the parable is an understanding of faith. The expert in the law spits out the correct answer. How many of us know the correct answer? Seriously, how many of us know where it comes from in Scripture? You see, if we don't study our Scriptures and make it a part of who we are, how can we expect to live a different life? How can we expect to know something differently? And that's why it's so vitally important to study our Scriptures, and to more particularly, study our Scriptures together. You know the parable about iron sharpening iron. Well, if you don't know that parable, there's an opportunity to learn about it. We are a people of the book. We need to remain a people of the book. And then once we learn, once we imbibe, once we make it a part of who we are, then we got to apply it. And once we apply it, then we got to share it. Because there's some wonderful, crazy things that happens when when we get in there and get all dirty and messy and when we see the ugliness of life. And I don't want to come across as being flippant. My attitude, I mean, I'm trying to be pretty joyous from time to time. Because this is a very serious thing. It's the crux of who we are as a people. Christians for thousands of years have been known not by being behind walls and being prayerful, but Christians have been known as the people who've gotten out in the middle of plagues, in the middle of war, in the middle of catastrophe, and being the hands of God in the midst of agony and pain. Does that mean that we stop what we're doing now? No. But it means maybe if we just take a moment, we might see the world slightly differently and open ourselves up to different possibilities. Now, for those in this room that may be offended by this, consider this. You might be thinking you're doing all that you can do. And if you are, praise God. But if you are upset, think of this. Why? Why would you be upset for this? Unless there's something inside of you that's poking and prodding. The model which has been established for us as being the model of how Christians are supposed to be is probably the least accurate way that Christians live out their life in reality, at least in this country and at least in this context of this culture. Why can't we be different? For some of us, you're already down that road. And I would encourage you to jump up and down and say, hey, let's all get down there together. There's no reason why this place can't be a center for change that affects many other places. Just because we happen to be located in what some people might consider a small community, what others may consider to be a safe community, still others might consider it to be, where are you from? Does not mean that you can't have a tremendous impact. Does not mean that you can't affect change in a world gone crazy. Does not mean that you can't reach out to people across the world. And I just don't mean writing a check. I'm talking about getting involved, being involved, doing things that we should be doing. If any of you have that desire, don't hesitate. Whom shall I send? Lord, send me. We have a great field for a harvest and few workers. Time is now. Don't wait any longer. Every moment you wait is a moment lost. And you can never get it back. Don't wait. Risk everything. See what happens. Yes, as Christians, I can tell you and I can guarantee you, I have laughed deeper, but I have cried harder. Because the world doesn't want you. And that should tell you something right there. I'm going to play a video. This is just a day for videos, isn't that great? If I had known this, I'd have got popcorn for everybody. I'm not allowed to have it anymore, but I'd have gotten it. Because I'd have sat back in the back and I'd have snuck stuff. So. That's what I have to add. So we're going to have about a 4-minute video, and then we'll have it there.
Singing verses 1 and 3. Will the ushers please come forward?
Savior, bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you. May a Holy Spirit, first working in you, convict you, put you in stead with God, and then working through you, enables you to reach out to the world. And may a Creator God who made you in God's image and hold you special and unique, may you embrace your identity and share it with the world. Go forth in peace and joy and hope and love and touch others with the same. And all of God's people said,
amen
and amen. Have a wonderful and blessed week.